I was like peak ballet. So I was probably dancing a lot of hours a week, and it was kind of my life. So it was fun to see movies that reflected that.
I was just doing tap dancing at the time.
Only tap dancing?
Yeah. I don't want to talk about it, though.
Oh, my God.
I don't want to talk about my tap dancing ever.
Oh, my God.
Did you see my new copy of Tap Dancing Monthly?
No.
It's on the table right there, but I don't want to talk about it. I used to tap dance. I don't anymore.
Right. Your tap dancing is a sore subject in our house.
I don't want to talk about it.
Okay, fine. We won't talk about it.
But, like, bring it up constantly because I really need to talk about it, but I don't want to talk about it.
On our podcast.
Well, you know what? I shouldn't say it. It's not official yet, but unofficially, welcome to I Love This. You should too.
What?
It's a bit from the movie.
Yeah, I know.
My name is Indy Tim Boots Randala. And with me is Samantha Hair Tendrils Hees.
Hair tendrils? Whoa. Yeah.
She was rocking some real tendrils.
She was. There was a lot of hair tendrils in this movie.
Yeah. Did you have those tendrils back in the day?
I did not. I didn't have great hair when I was 13.
Oh, nobody did.
Remember?
Who had great hair when they were 13? There's nobody you look at and you're like, wow, you had great hair when you were 13.
There were some girls in my junior high that I wished I had their hair, but...
Well, if you haven't been able to tell yet, today we are talking about a movie that really encapsulates the late 90s in Chicago and what Michael Jordan meant to not just that city, not just the league, but the world, and the documentary series, The Last Dance.
No.
Wait, what?
We watched Save the Last Dance?
Oh!
Different movie about Chicago.
I am going to change my ultimate answer about whether I love this or not.
Oh, okay. So now that Indy is on the same page as me on what movie we watched, we are I Love This, You Should Too, and we're a member of the Alberta Podcast Network, which is locally grown and community supported. And we are so lucky to have sponsors who help us do what we do. And the first one is Taproot, which publishes a weekly food roundup sharing the latest on restaurants, chefs, producers, events, and more. It's curated by Sharon Yeo, a longtime blogger at Only Here for the Food and a keen student of Edmonton's food scene. Subscribe to the food roundup for free at taprootedmonton.ca. That's taprootedmonton.ca.
I need to get on that one because now I think I'm ready to leave the house again and go to restaurants.
Yeah.
And I'm in the market for some good recommendations, so I'm going to check out that Taproot.
Yeah.
And then they also have other ones on, like, tech and whatnot, but today, we're all about the food.
Today, I'm all about the food. I spent all day calling food trucks, so now I'm just thinking about food.
Yeah, that's how hungry she was. She ordered a food truck for lunch.
Just one food truck, please.
just bring it on over. I'll take care of the rest.
No, I didn't get a food truck because apparently you can't just call and have one delivered.
No.
So, Indy, we watched 2001's Save the Last Dance. In 2001, I loved it.
And 20 years later?
I did not.
Yeah.
This was a full 2 hours of cringe.
Oh, wow. You went that far.
I did.
I thought you would still like it. Do you like it?
Not really.
No.
No, it's stupid.
Well, it is quite stupid, yeah.
I couldn't think of a better word. It's
but often,
stupid.
Like, this is throwing me for a loop here, because usually I, go about breaking it down and explaining to you why it's stupid.
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay, fine, you might be right, but I still like it. But
no.
You're there from the beginning.
I'm going in full stupid today.
Clearly, I didn't love it, but we kind of saw that coming.
Yeah, yeah.
But right after the movie, I was much more angry about it.
No.
I didn't like it at all. I was like, this was, yeah, it was stupid.
It was stupid.
Looking at it today, I'm like, yeah, there was some good stuff. There were some fun bits about it. So I have actually softened on it.
I didn't like how racialized this movie was.
Okay.
I'm sure we'll talk about it.
We will, because if you didn't bring it up, I was going to ask you, based on how I talk about every movie... Why would you show me this movie and expect me not to just, get into this for an hour? But you are, ahead of the game again, in both in saying it's stupid and about the racial dynamics of it. Yes.
So this was one that I hadn't watched right before I suggested it to you. This was one that came up on my Netflix.
You haven't seen since you were a teenager.
I felt like maybe we should do a dance movie after the princess movies that we just did. Really like throwing it back to young Samantha. So
I say lean into that.
Well, and that's what I'm trying to do. Yeah. I'm trying to bring you more things that I loved as a young ballerina princess.
And then I can crush your childhood.
Exactly. That's what all good marriages are based on.
Hey, you know those things you love? Here's why they're dumb.
Here's why they're dumb and I hate them. So I just, now looking on it, I'm like, this is not a movie I would ever bring you if I actually really liked it, because you would, like you said, tell me why you hated it and it was dumb.
But I think you should bring it if you like it and you think I'll tear it apart, because if it holds up to that, or if you can say, like, but here's why that doesn't matter, or the good things make up for it, then you, I don't know, win at life? Win the podcast? You win the podcast.
I win the podcast. Okay.
But, I like that you did this without watching it, because I think I'm going to do a couple of those coming up.
Okay.
Like my favorite movies from when I was 14.
Okay. Yeah. So I hadn't watched this one before, and I kind of hate not knowing what we're going into. I just really feel uncomfortable with that, which is why I watch The Princess Diaries, both movies back to back, before I even started the whole series with you.
Mm-hmm.
And which is why I watch a lot of movies beforehand. And maybe this is a Bride Wars insecurity, because I didn't watch that one beforehand. So I feel like if I had watched this, I never would have brought it to the podcast.
Yeah, I like that you didn't, because I think when the whole Bride Wars incident happened, we were so early in the podcast that you more equated me saying this movie is terrible to saying you are terrible,
yes,
or at least your taste is terrible.
True.
Which is not the case. I think we've gotten to the point now where I can say a movie is junk and you're like, yeah, that's that movie. That's not me.
True.
And I know you're not going to love Raging Bull, but you can still love me. Well, that's fine. We've gotten to the point where we can talk about the movies as not just representations of us.
Very true. It's very true. And we have like more defined roles, and we can kind of move past.
We have more defined rules?
Roles.
Oh, roles. Oh, we have more defined roles?
Yeah.
How so?
In that, like, you're...
Oh, you're the fun time, good, happy one, and I'm like the curmudgeon-y jerk.
No!
But on the podcast, yeah, totally.
I'm
right?
The fun time, happy one, yeah. And you're like the soliloquizing smart guy.
I think curmudgeon. a curmudgeon who loves Spider-Man cartoons, though.
Yeah, there you go.
Wow, well, this was a good session of marriage counseling.
I was going to say, that kind of just describes what we're like in our relationship every day.
Wait, I'm not the curmudgeon there.
No.
I'm the good time, fun, happy one.
You're the soliloquizing smart guy.
I think outside of podcast, I'm the good time, happy one. You're a good time, happy when it comes to eating salty foods. I'm good time, happy when it comes to activities and like general demeanor.
Okay, sure. Sure.
We can good time happy ones. We have no curmudgeon.
We have no curmudgeon.
Outside of the podcast. In the podcast, though, I'm very curmudgeon.
Okay, well, if you're going to own it, then yes, you are a curmudgeon.
Yeah. Damn kids on my lawn.
He's shaking his fist right now.
This, I'm going to try to segue this into the movie we're talking about.
Oh,
Save
what?
The Last Dance.
We're not just talking about our...
This was the time when I first became curmudgeonly. I thought at a very young age, like, I'm going to be a great old man, because in 2001, I was like, hip-hop music is junk now, back in my day. And everyone's like, Indy, you're like 16. And I was like, yeah, no, but trust me, when I was 10, oh shit, it was good then. Because I only listened to hip-hop from the ages of like 6 through 17, 18. And then I discovered the old rock and roll. But before that, I only listened to hip-hop, and this was like one of those turning points where it became more mainstream and worse. And I don't think it's like, a hipster thing of like, well, now everyone likes it, so I don't. I think, well, when we do an episode on just hip hop in general, I'll talk about how things changed. But 2001 hip hop is where it started losing me.
Interesting.
And much of that was due to the soundtrack of Save the Last Dance, which is hugely popular and very well loved by people who were first introduced to hip hop through this soundtrack. And to someone like me, who was, like, even at a very young age, very studious in my music listening.
You are very studious in everything that you approach.
That's actually probably true. So then this becoming so popular and reaching such a wide audience when it was such a watered-down version of what I loved was very upsetting to me as a teenager. And now let's relive all of that. So first things, what struck you about this being cringy?
Like I said, the racialization in this movie.
What do you mean by racialization?
I feel like there is a very stereotypical brush that they used. A, like, white person stereotypical brush they used to write all of the black characters in this movie.
I'm very glad you said that, because when we talked about Bring It On, you had the opposite. You said, like, oh, I hate what they did. And I was like, yeah, me too. But you had the exact opposite view as me on that one.
Coming around. Am I woke now?
Well, the first part of being woke is using the word woke.
That's so. What I thought. That's the first time I've said it out loud.
Yeah.
I practiced at my desk today in my head.
And then you had to say AF.
Oh, woke AF.
I'm going to start mixing it up. I'm going to say I'm woke a fuck or woke as F.
I love that. Did you see how I was holding my hands? I had like Alexis hands when I said woke AF.
Well, you usually do.
I usually do. You're right. I do hold my hands really high and bend at the wrist.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the soundtrack to this movie reminds me of like grade 7 school dances.
Yeah.
I feel like there was a lot of this. And now I'm thinking about it and I'm like, I feel like 12-year-olds should not be dancing all up on each other to this music.
Well, they can listen to the music, but just not be all up on each other.
No, they were all up on each other.
Well, that's your school's fault, not the soundtrack's fault.
It's very true. The other things I didn't really like about this movie were the lack of parents.
Mm-hmm.
And just like the way that they wrote Sarah.
Okay. We'll get into that because I'm curious to see what your issues with her are, because I feel like they might differ from my issues with her.
Okay. Okay.
All right. Well, let's get into the movie. How's this one start off?
So the beginning of the movie, the first like 5 to 10 minutes, there's a lot of plot that happens in it. So I'll just quickly let you know. 17-year-old Sarah, who is played by Julia Stiles, is on the cusp of a promising ballet career when she tries out for Juilliard and she begs her mom to attend the audition.
Yeah. So first of all, she's like, Mom, you need to be there. And their relationship is a little odd to me. They're too involved in each other.
Very true. Like, my mom and I are very close.
Very, yeah.
But, like, I go and do things on my own.
You're able to do that.
I'm able to, like, have experiences without her.
And we are jumping, of course, but that stays with her. Sarah is her name?
Sarah.
She also can't audition without her boyfriend there later.
She needs someone watching her.
There's like a weird codependence thing in her character.
So as someone who was like almost a professional dancer, you don't get to bring people to auditions.
This whole audition, all of the auditions, we'll talk about the second audition later. They're weird.
No, I've never been to an audition like that. Granted, I've never tried out for Juilliard, but it's like, you don't get to bring your mom. My mom has never been to an audition that I've done. You don't do some weird self-choreographed hip-hop dance. And if you fall, generally, they'll let you go again. Because first time you fall, it's maybe a slippery stage. The second time, it's dancer error. So.
But it was a very hectic day at the flower shop for her.
Yeah.
that shot of in the flower shop, and they're trying to make it look as busy as possible, yeah. but it's still a flower shop.
Yeah.
So it's just people moving flowers from one side of the room
yeah,
to the other.
That was weird. And like, so dumb. Not how retail stores work.
The beginning of this movie is very poorly directed.
It is.
And I don't think that's an issue throughout the movie.
No,
so it's almost like
chaotic and weird.
Yeah. It's almost like they had their second unit doing all this montage stuff, because it does not look or feel like the rest of the movie.
It's very true. And that's why I was like, we should just synopsis the first, like,
yeah,
10 minutes.
Because I have issue with all of the movie, but I think the direction through most of it is solid.
Mm, and it's, like, nice to look at. They yeah. do a good job. But, yeah, I would agree with you. And I don't have the film background to, like, think about first and second teams.
Right.
But, like, I found the beginning of this movie, like, kind of almost throwaway.
It looked bad, and yeah. it was poorly edited. Mm-hmm. It was just bad.
So, after she makes her mother attend this audition, she falls and soon learns that her mother was killed in a car accident.
And they edit it together, so the fall and the car accident are happening
yes.
at the same time. So, begging the question, did the disgruntled ghost come and trip her?
I think that Sarah and her mom are so weirdly close, like TLC smothered close, that they have like that twin telepathy thing.
Yeah. So she felt her mom dying.
She felt her mom dying, and yeah. she fell down on the stage.
That's probably what it was.
I think.
It's the most important day of my life.
Ah, you have to be there. Please drive dangerously to make sure that I get what I want. So then Sarah decides that she's just going to give up ballet. And then she moves to the south side of Chicago to live with her father, who is a jazz musician and is never home.
No.
Unless he decides he's having a strict parenting moment, and then he's home all the time.
What's he doing during the day? Because he doesn't have like a day job.
Sleeping,
does he?
I'm assuming. Because he like plays jazz clubs till real late.
Yeah.
That's what he said. I'll be gone till real late. This whole her moving in with her father is very strange, because Sarah at this point seems like she's like 25.
Yeah,
and
she's
yeah, like,
the only one who's close to her age, but she's yeah. like 20 or something.
Yeah, and she's being like forced into this like little girl role almost.
And the place where she's staying looks like those sets in Rent.
Mm-hmm.
You got me to watch Rent, where it's like decrepit, but like too perfectly decrepit.
Yes, but like has been abandoned for 10 years.
Yeah,
but
it looks like a joke.
But is also like cool and edgy.
I felt it read like a sitcom joke of a bad apartment.
Oh, for
sure.
It
didn't read authentic. It no. read silly.
It did look like a set in theater.
Yes.
Where like, oh, I'm going to make this wall like exposed beam. And then someone spends like 2 days plastering and making this like exposed beam perfect. So I thought that the apartment was like kind of dumb. After she gets settled into her father's living room couch, she goes to a high school on the south side, which is a majority black high school. And then we meet all of these characters, and we watch her be scared of people for
and she's
almost a full day.
The only white person in most of these shots, and she's also the only one wearing colored clothes. Everyone
yeah.
else wears black and gray. And she's all brightly colored. There's one other white person in her class at one point
mm-hmm.
who also just gets cutaway shots of her rolling her eyes at the antics of black people.
Yeah.
Which felt weird and unnecessary.
It feels terrible.
Because at this point, Sarah's actually doing all right. She doesn't seem like overly scared or anything. They're not playing up any sort of danger. If there's any good thing about this character, she does, for the most part, reserve judgment in most situations.
And she's trying to fit into her new life.
Yeah.
I feel like she's at the point with her grief that she's like, well, this is my life now. I'm not a dancer anymore. I go to this high school. I guess I just have to, like, graduate.
Yeah, it was like me with my tap all those years ago.
You did tap?
I don't want to talk about it! Why would you think I want to talk about it? Just because I bring it up constantly? I don't know. I don't want to talk about it.
The entire bookshelf related to tap magazines that
you're
you
not
have.
Supposed to see that, even you're... though I have it displayed for everyone. Oh, yeah, so
gold dip tap shoes.
When she's on the bus going to Chicago, she has her ballet magazine out. And someone goes, oh, do you do ballet? I used to. And she's all like sullen and moody about it.
And then looks out the window really dramatically. Yeah, it's a confusing movie because she clearly wants to talk about ballet, but also wants to yell at people for wanting to talk about ballet with her. So we see Kerry Washington.
Thank God.
Very young Kerry Washington.
So I'm not familiar with her.
Yeah.
I only learned that she was a big deal afterwards. I went to IMDb and I was like, oh, she's done all sorts of stuff. Mm-hmm. She saves this movie.
She does.
She's by far
fantastic.
The best person in this movie. And at some points I felt bad for her having to act opposite Julia Stiles. And sometimes I felt thankful for her because, man, Julia Stiles, none of your jokes are landing if you don't have Kerry Washington going like, oh, snap.
Yeah, because she's like a physical actor as well as very good at line delivery.
She's just a breath of fresh air in a very stagnant movie.
Oh, absolutely. She was great. Absolutely. She's really big in some of Shonda Rhimes's shows. Shonda Rhimes, who wrote the second Princess Diaries? Is that what?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's her claim to fame, right? Writer of Princess Diaries 2.
Grey's Anatomy, Scandal, which is where Kerry Washington is from. So I was really excited to see her because I really like Kerry Washington. She does a really good, sassy, bold, strong woman character. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of interested to see what she was going to bring to this role, which
that
was amazing to see her doing this like 20 years before she became, maybe 15 years before she became really popular with this role that she's playing in a high school.
Yeah, I wasn't familiar with her. But just watching her, I was like, oh, why isn't this person the star? Because she's like, she just commands the screen much more than mm-hmm. the other people in this movie do.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. And I'm glad that, she was there because she made it so that Sarah didn't look so flat.
Yes. This is what a supporting actor has to do, like, in the worst case scenario. Mm-hmm. Because she doesn't just get to do her own thing and we celebrate, like, her performance. She has to bring up some pretty flat performances, which is like even more difficult, and she does a great job of it. Not so great that I think Julia Stiles is charismatic, but still pretty good.
Yeah, absolutely. So Kerry Washington, teenage single mother, she's having relationship problems. She has a brother who she's trying to get into medical school. She's got friends who really enjoy people who are in gangs. She just wants to be a teenager, but she also feels this strong affinity to her child. So she's got a lot going on.
And yet none of it's explored.
And none of it's explored, and none of it's important when it's inconvenient.
Yeah, absolutely. Well said.
It's like, no, you can go out until 1 a.m. dancing every night. Your grandmother will take care of your baby. Or like, if you decide to revoke custody from your ex-boyfriend when he's trying to take your baby for a weekend, that's fine too. You'll just go out with your friends. That's fine. And it's just like silly the way that they deal with some of these like actual real world problems.
Because every character, every issue in this movie only exists when it is convenient for Julia Stiles' character. Mm-hmm. This entire world exists to prop her up. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of like the big flaw of the movie.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What are some of your favorite lines that Kerry Washington has?
Oh, I like when they're walking out of a classroom and someone's dancing and Julia Stiles is kind of like scared. And she goes, relax, it's just a little hip hop. Because that's how people talk.
Yeah, exactly.
What's yours?
Probably when Julia Stiles is going to Steps, which is spelled with two P's.
Yeah. Is it an acronym?
I don't know. But Kerry Washington corrects her when she says, oh, I like your outfit. Or nice outfit.
It's cool or something?
Cool outfit?
You look really cool. That's a cool outfit. Something like that.
That's a cool outfit. And Kerry Washington says, slammin'. It's a slammin' outfit.
She's like, oh.
Oh, got
thank
it.
Thank you, wise black woman, yes. For teaching me the ways of the streets.
I would like to know the street lingo, please.
And the things they make Kerry Washington say. Terrible. And from her, seems all right.
Kind of charming.
Yeah. She's very good.
Somehow very charming. So Chenille, she's kind of Sarah's guardian angel through this whole experience.
For no reason.
No reason.
She just helps her once so her bag doesn't get stolen and then just takes her under her wing because she's just a good person who goes around helping lost white people.
Apparently.
She's already has one in her group that she's rescued from somewhere.
Nikki? Is that her name?
Or is it Nikki the other one?
I can't remember, but...
Because there's her one friend who's like mean that looks like Aaliyah.
Oh, that's... Yes, that's Derek's ex-girlfriend, Nikki.
That's Nikki, yeah.
I can't remember...
The white friend's name.
But yeah, there's one girl who's just trying so hard to be black, and it's kind of sad to watch.
But isn't that like the message of this movie? Is like, all you have to do is sit like this and say slam, and now you're black.
Yeah, exactly.
It's kind of what this movie is positing.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So throughout her first day at school and going to Steps, Sarah develops this hatred of Derek, who is Chenille's brother.
Right, so we meet Derek in class, and because they are debating literature like no high school students ever have.
Mm-hmm.
I have taught high school English. It's not like that at all. No, nobody is like the two of them.
No.
Derek is just a confounding character in many ways. A problematic character in many ways as well.
Problematic how?
Oh, well, maybe we should save all of our race stuff for at the end when we, like, really get into the thematic stuff of it.
Okay.
But he's this, almost like a stereotype of this exemplary Negro, is what it's often called in, where it's just someone who's like, oh, see, he's one of the good ones. And it's a tool used not to say, like, hey, black people are great. It's, in fact, done to do the opposite because it's you're one of the exemplary ones. You're the exception to the rule.
Right.
Most of you people are bad. You're one of the good ones. So it's a really, like, I don't want to say catch 22 because I just finished reading that and then people use it wrong all the time, but it's kind of a catch 22 of you think that we're promoting the cause, the advancement of black people by putting in this role, but in fact you're doing the opposite because you're saying only if you get a scholarship to, where's he going, Georgetown. And you're going to be a doctor, and you're leaving behind all of those criminal things, and you rescue every white person you see. You're the one of the good ones. Mm-hmm. Everyone else is not. So it's a difficult character and a difficult performance. I don't even know what to take away from his performance.
It's kind of like pointless love interest, but also like with a cause, like, stapled 100 times onto it.
Yeah, it's
like, it's
strange.
So forcefully pushed.
But at this point in the movie, all we know is he is way too old to be in that class.
Yes.
He's over 30.
Yeah.
And you can tell.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very uncomfortable when the two of them get together because she's like a teenager and he's a 30-year-old man. And it's...
Yes.
Yeah, it's uncomfortable.
Absolutely. Also... racially, I didn't enjoy that she only, like, was interested in the guy who wants to go to Georgetown.
Yeah, there's so much of this.
We'll talk about that later again, but I just felt like, great. Derek is, you know, studious and nice, and he wants more for his future, but, like, Sarah shouldn't, you know, automatically just be with him.
Why is he interested in her?
Zero reasons.
There's no reason at all.
She's awful.
It seems like they really dislike each other at the beginning, mm-hmm. but that's also a trope in so many romantic movies that I really hate, especially teenage ones.
Yes.
Where the guy is antagonistic and that's how he shows he cares.
It's like the, this isn't grade six. Likes you because he punches you on the playground.
Yeah, you're not a six-year-old doing that. Like, you should know better at this point, and the writer should know better, and audiences should expect better.
Oh, absolutely.
But yeah, I guess that's what they were going for here, but there's no point where things turn in my mind. Because mm-mm. then they go dancing. This is another one of Julia Stiles' great lines when someone says, oh, we don't square dance here. She goes, that's all right. I dance in circles.
Probably around you.
And everyone, Kerry Washington's like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
Which she's helping. She's doing what she can to help out her friend. Yeah. But so then they go dance and that's a painful, painful scene. If you are near the top of the world in ballet, as she was, because she's almost in Juilliard at mm-hmm. this point, you've probably never heard music before, though, right?
No, yeah. Like, you wouldn't have taken a hip-hop class.
It's not just that she doesn't know, like, choreographed hip-hop dance. Mm-hmm. Because this movie doesn't seem to know there's a difference between, like, a choreographed hip-hop routine and then people dancing at a club. Mm-hmm. People aren't doing choreographed routines at the club.
No.
They're pretty much bobbing along to the beat.
Yeah.
And she can't do that.
No.
She does not understand what a beat is. It's not just that she's never heard hip-hop music before. She's never heard music before.
Yes.
She's never danced when someone didn't choreograph it for her. Mm-hmm. So it looks very, very awkward. It's like an alien trying to dance for the first time.
So this was one of the things that I feel like they got right.
In how bad of a dancer she was?
In how bad of a dancer she was.
So you can't dance to anything if you're trained in ballet?
I don't think I realized that there was other, like, that you could just, like, free dance.
Okay.
Until I was, like, going to school dances and saw my friends doing it and, like, got comfortable with it.
But you understand, like, four beats.
Yes.
Right? You wouldn't be, like, one, two, three, one, three, four. Like,
no,
you know,
so
it's
she,
one and
they
two,
did
and
a
three,
bad job
four.
Of directing her through it, but I can feel some solidarity with her.
I think it was too bad.
Because, like, 12-year-old Samantha didn't realize how to work hips while dancing.
12 is very different yes. than a senior in high school.
No, absolutely, absolutely. Like, she should know by now, but I can just say that, like, I do remember that awkwardness, and I remember not knowing how to, like, reprogram my brain.
I want to hear from all you other dancers out there, yeah. because as we learned last episode, for some reason, I've dated several ballerinas. I found they could all dance.
I could dance eventually. It just was like a weird reprogramming of the brain.
You just needed someone to, like, take you aside, teach you how to walk, teach you how to sit.
Yes.
And then yeah. you're like, okay, now I get it.
Yeah, got it. Thanks. No, I definitely think she should have learned this before she was auditioning for Juilliard. Because she looks very awkward.
Yeah. Well, she looks awkward when she's doing ballet as well.
True.
And I like that this club only plays censored music.
Yes.
You have to be 21 to get in, but, like, oh, we can't swear here.
No, there's no swearing.
There are pretty often fist fights, but no swearing.
No swearing, butt punching.
Butt punching?
No.
Whose butt got punched?
Butt, comma, punching.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Sarah and Derek somehow become friends after learning how to dance together, and he spends all of this money to take her to the ballet, and she, like, almost doesn't go.
Yeah, because I think this is the point where we learn that she links ballet with killing her mom.
Yeah.
Which I get that. I see the line there.
Yeah.
I also say that is terrible script writing. That's bad motivation to be like, oh yeah, my mom died, so now I can't do ballet yeah. because I need a conflict or else my character has nothing to it. That's
exactly.
what it sounds like to me.
It does. It does. It's flimsy, and they could have beefed that up a little bit.
Very easily.
Yeah. But it just, like, if she was unable to dance after her mom got hit by a car.
Sure. Like, it's in her mind. She doesn't quite know
yeah,
how to do it.
Yeah, she's got a mental block.
Yeah, that makes sense. Or if it was more of that she felt guilty because her mom put so much time into things mm-hmm. and then she's just not good enough and it's more of a self-confidence thing. But the way this movie presents it, it's like, I do ballet, so my mom died, so I can't do ballet anymore because it'll double kill my mom. I don't know.
Extra killer.
Yeah.
She's going to be so killed.
She was pretty killed.
She was, you're right. I feel like maybe lots of the viewers don't know how much tickets to the Joffrey Ballet where they were sitting would be, but those are like $250 a ticket.
Damn.
So, like, to not go would be very insulting and upsetting, especially for a high school student who spent $500 on a date.
Yeah. Who looks like he lives in a pretty junk place. Yeah. Doesn't have a job.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Does he?
No, he doesn't.
Like, how does that family survive? It's a grandma, the baby, and the two of them.
Yeah.
Now I'm worried about them.
Me too.
I'm glad they're fictitious.
Me too. Kerry Washington. Good thing she had an acting breakout so that she could support that family.
So one of the very few things I know about this, and maybe you already know it, is at the time she was a substitute teacher when she got this role.
Yeah.
So she went and did it, and because of whatever her contract with MTV was, she got paid so little, she had to keep teaching.
And seriously?
She had to stop teaching high school because all the people would be like, oh shit, it's Chenille, right? Yeah. So she could only teach elementary school after that because it was just too much of an ordeal.
Wow.
And then eventually she got other movies that actually paid her.
That's crazy. I did not know that, actually. Yeah.
So then she learns how to dance, and then they go to the club and dance again. And everybody stops and watches them.
Yeah, everyone's like amazed.
And it is not an impressive
dance. No, everyone's like, whoa!
Every dance in this movie is not terribly impressive.
That's what people are like.
They were.
And it's not that great. She just like learned how to move her arms and legs in unison.
Which really she should be able to do by this point.
Derek dances with his ex-girlfriend Nikki, and
do you have that actress's name?
Bianca Lawson.
So Bianca Lawson has been playing teenagers since 1994.
Really?
She was on the reboot of Saved by the Bell.
Oh.
And I haven't watched her later stuff, but I looked at her IMDb. She is still playing teenagers as of 5 years ago.
To this day? How old is she now?
No, she's not a teenager. So she has like a 30-year career of playing teenagers, of playing high school students.
That's hilarious.
Which is impressive. Like, good for you. I'm not condemning her or anything.
She's
if you can.
42.
Yeah.
She looks incredible for 42.
Right? She does look like Aaliyah, right?
Yes, she does.
Or at least how her hair and stuff were in this movie.
She like literally hasn't aged. I think it's the hairstyle that makes her look like Aaliyah.
Yeah, because when you see her in other stuff, you don't get
no.
that. But I think that was just a look of the time.
I think
she's... Her and Aaliyah both had it going on.
For sure. Was Aaliyah still alive at this point?
I believe so. I'm not sure. It's probably close to that point.
I remember when she died, but I don't remember when it was.
I feel like it was after, but I'm not sure about that.
So Sarah and Derek go to her dad's apartment, and the subtext is that they have sex.
It was a jarring scene because up to this point they never kiss.
Yeah.
Oh, except there's the one train lady scene,
right?
But that's like not even real
that
kissing.
Felt jarring because it was like all of a sudden they went from hating each other to like being really touchy-feely on the train.
Yeah. And then so in this scene where they have sex, they hadn't kissed to this point.
No.
And that's weird.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird to have a love story, which is pretty much what this movie is,
mm-hmm.
and not know if they're together until like 3/4 way through the movie. And not like, will they get together?
No,
they've been together the
whole
time.
Do you even like each other?
Yeah. And that can't be an intentional thing, because you could say like, oh, it's suspense of will they get together? But it wasn't played like that.
No.
They were together all the time, doing things all the time, but it just didn't seem romantic.
Yeah. It's very strange.
Maybe it's just because he's 31 and she's in high school. But it just didn't seem like they were a couple at all. So it kind of grossed me out when they were having sex. Also, because he's 31 and she's in high school.
Could you drive that fact home one more time?
Just watch the movie. It's going to drive it home. I don't know. It's
very obvious.
I don't know why.
That is a man who has done medical school.
Yes.
And has somehow ended up back in high school.
Yeah.
So Derek gets into Georgetown, and because of that, he convinces Sarah to follow her dreams of Juilliard and finds the Chicago audition.
Do you know like 24 people a year get into the Juilliard dance program?
Yeah. I remember in high school.
Stiles? Come on.
I remember in high school, them telling us that, like, they take one Canadian a year.
Yeah.
From all of Canada. And I went to an arts high school where they did absolutely everything they could do to encourage us. And they were like, yeah, Juilliard might be a little bit of a long shot.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Is this when we get the scene where they go to the hospital or like the doctor's office or something because Kerry Washington's kid is sick? Did that happen in this movie?
Yes, it did.
Okay. I just remember her looking around at all like the sick black children, and they should have been playing like Sarah McLachlan songs because it looked like it was shot like one of those, if you have a dollar a day, you could support this starving child. It looked like one of those infomercial type things. It was offensively shot.
So the doctor's office scene happens right after Nikki and Sarah have a fight.
Oh, right, right. Talk about that.
Nikki being Derek's ex-girlfriend, mm-hmm. who is like no good, and he's on to bigger and better things.
Right.
Which is apparently Sarah.
Yeah.
And then Chenille takes Nikki's side, basically, and says that she understands Nikki's bitterness because Sarah is stealing one of the decent black men that they have in the community.
What did you think about all that?
That was ridiculously offensive.
Which part?
All of it.
Okay, let's save it, and we're going to break that down later.
Okay, sounds good.
Because I have thoughts as well.
Okay.
So yeah, then we go to the doctor, and then Sarah breaks up with Derek because she says, like, we spend all of our time defending our relationship, which never really happened. Oh yeah, I guess it happened a couple times.
Yeah, I mean, it happened a few times. It was very light. Mm-hmm. Derek has this friend, Malakai.
Oh, Malakai, Fredro Starr. How have we not talked about Fredro Starr yet?
Who is Fredro Starr?
Fredro Starr. Man, I was a huge fan of his as a musician. He did a lot of movies and TV as well. I think he's most popular from Moesha. He was on the Moesha show.
Oh, okay.
But he is one of the four founding members of Onyx, who I was a huge fan of when I was like 10 years old. And if you listen to Onyx, you know what? I'm sure I could do it right now. Here is 10 seconds of Onyx. Onyx is wrecking shit. Slip, slide, step quick. Super on a tin and the kids pass like a minute. The shit they write is black and white. Well, mine's got mad color. Ain't that right? Run, brother. Word up. Raise it up. We do it with the Cruetto. Give a fuck. So throw your guns in the air. So what do you think of that?
That was interesting.
Interesting. That's, nobody ever says anything good is interesting.
No, I can see why you like it.
You hit you a little too hard
because
on that.
You but like hip hop.
But wait, listen to the difference between these two. I can see why you like it. I can see why you like it.
Oh, no.
Do you hear it?
No, I didn't mean to.
No, yeah, because I like rap, right?
Don't make and
I
me grew an up accidental on... racist.
No, there's nothing racist about okay. it. You don't like that kind of music.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Okay, good.
But it's not the most accessible hip-hop, like a lot of the stuff we get in this. It's at the time, it was called hardcore. Like, mm-hmm. That's hardcore rap. And it was very profane, and there's lots of violence in it, but... he came from Onyx, and when I was 12, I think, I had this Onyx t-shirt, and the name of their album was Back to Fuck Up, and it said that, but it's spelled B-A-C-D-A-F-U-C-U-P, Back to Fuck Up, is one thing. So I was like, I really want to wear my Onyx shirt to school, but I don't want to get in trouble. My mom didn't know what I meant because it's just one big word. So I tried I did wear it to school and nobody called me on it. Mm. But a tiny bit of rebellion in me was like, haha, I got away with this. So I was a very big Onyx fan. The first CD I ever bought was Onyx.
Oh, that's exciting.
At Sam the Record Man for $29.99. It's crazy.
CDs were so expensive.
This is like probably in 94 or so.
I think my first one was Spice Girls.
Oh.
Or Britney Spears, one of the two.
Yeah, we had a little bit of different tastes.
Yeah, just just slightly. Why do you like me?
That's the thing with the podcast, remember? Yeah. You can be very different. It's our differences that make us stronger.
Aww.
That's my speech on... multiculturalism as well. But anyways, yeah, Malakai, we haven't talked about him much here, but he's a general troublemaker.
Yeah, he's gonna go do a drive-by shooting?
Yeah, But before we talk about that, his performance. What did you think of Fred Rowe in this?
He was very convincing.
I thought he gave one of the best performances.
Yeah, for
Kerry
sure.
Kerry Washington, of course, commands the screen because she's charismatic and refreshing with all those flat performances around her. But what Fredro Starr does, he brings an authenticity to it that I don't think anyone else had.
No.
I don't think a single other person I believed was that person. Mm-hmm. Like even Kerry Washington. And it's not because she was a bad actor. Quite the opposite. It's just that she wasn't a high school student. She didn't look like it. And also, I don't believe that he was a Fredro being a high school student, but I believed him as someone who was going to do a drive-by. I was like, yeah, I could see that.
Yeah, he was... like, legitimately scared.
And because that's also who I knew him as, because that's kind of his persona as a musician, too, right?
Mm-hmm.
When he was with Onyx, he's kind of cultivating that, so that's already what I think of him, but I thought he was very good in it.
So, Malakai.
Oh, yeah, he's planning the drive-by, and he's going to say, hey, Derek, you have to join us because, you know, I helped you out before.
Because Malakai went to jail instead of Derek, so that Derek could become a pediatrician.
But if that's the case, then Malakai would also be like, yeah, don't do this. Don't fuck up your life. Stay out of this.
Yeah. He's a very strange friend.
Yeah.
And so Sarah is at her Juilliard audition. Derek said that he was going to be there, but also is somehow going to be at a drive-by. And he has a change of heart and decides to leave. And Sarah does her audition and falls. Does she fall again?
She does the ballet one, and apparently it's good, but it's not. Like, I've only been to the ballet 4 or 5 times. I saw a lot of high school ballet. Hmm. They're all better than she was in this. You're a dancer. Was it good?
No.
Did you think it was good when you were a kid and you saw it?
No.
Like, I don't get why they can't get that part good. You're already using a body double, and it's very apparent.
So that's
so then
what
just
was...
use the body double for everything and make it good. Use a good body double.
They didn't use a good body double. And I feel like I spent so much time doing ballet that I am very critical of it.
But I haven't, and I'm not critical of it, and this looked bad.
Yes, and it did look bad. And I'm just like, I don't understand why. It's like when fashion designers do a ballet-inspired line, and they use models in pointe shoes instead of actual ballerinas who are, like, sometimes skinnier than models and, like, look great in high-fashion clothing. And it's just like, why wouldn't you use the real thing?
Spike Lee said when he was making He Got Game, he cast Ray Allen, who is an NBA player, as the lead in this movie as a basketball player. He believed it's easier to get a basketball player who can act convincingly than it is to get an actor who can convincingly play basketball.
Oh, for sure.
And I don't think he's wrong. No. Because you go to any... You go to Juilliard, you go to one of those people who is a dancer, they're probably also an actor anyway.
I mean,
there are a lot of people who can dance and act.
Well, dancing is acting. Any of those storybook ballets, you're being Romeo, you're being Juliet, you're being anyone.
I feel like this is a big debate, and I want to argue with you it's not.
No, but it's very similar. You're encompassing a role.
Sure, sure.
You're becoming that person, and I feel like it would be very easy to get a dancer who could act.
But if we're recasting it, I would also, instead of just casting her with someone who could dance, I would also cast her with someone who could act.
Agreed.
Like, I think that's probably the most controversial thing I'm going to say on this episode, because people love Julia Stiles.
They do.
I don't quite know why. But, okay, we won't even look at her career as a whole.
No.
In this movie, is she good?
No.
I think she's quite bad.
She's quite bad. She's so flat.
Wooden and flat. Yeah, flat. Yeah. It's just, she's just like a...
beige wall.
I was going to say a bowl of unsweetened oatmeal.
Oh, okay.
She's just oatmeal up there.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I guess she got the job done, but, like, I'd like to enjoy it.
So Sarah has Derek on the stage during her audition?
Oh, yeah. So then Derek runs in and says, well, wait, stop, stop, stop. And the guy's like, you can't be in here.
No.
And he's like, well, I am.
So
they talk for like 5 minutes while the Juilliard people just wait. Like there's nobody else in line.
Yeah, like there's 17 other people waiting to audition. Also, is it 10 p.m.?
Yeah.
So because what time do drive-bys happen?
I'm going to say 9 or later.
That's what I thought. Okay.
Not too many, like 3 in the afternoon drive-bys.
Because it's dark.
It's definitely
after
dark.
School.
Yeah.
She seems to have had an entire day's worth of stuff. It's like a 10 p.m. Juilliard audition.
Yes, at least. Wait, don't they say like for the drive-by? I thought they had a time that it's at like 9:30. So it's after 9. It's probably like 10 at least.
Yeah, because he's like, oh, you ready to go? And they're all getting into the car. Yeah, and Derek's like, no, man, I can't do this. And
then he goes across town.
So he has a full conversation with his sister where she's like, Sarah loves you.
Oh, right, because then Kerry Washington has to say, like, oh, I said something to her, that's why she
I was
that.
Rude. Yeah. And then he runs all the way downtown to where her Juilliard audition is. So it's been, like, an hour at least. Like, minimum.
Conservatively, it's 10:30 at
night. And the Juilliard people are still seeing dancers, and they're cool with them having a 10-minute conversation. I'd be like, it's 10:45 at night. Like,
you've also auditioned twice this year and you've fallen twice. So I think we're good.
I think we've seen all we need to see.
And also the ballet was terrible.
Yeah. So then Sarah's accepted into Juilliard somehow.
Because we never even got to the basis of this movie is that he teaches her hip hop dancing and that's going to help her get into Juilliard as a ballerina.
Yeah.
I get that you'd want to be varied and show that you have more than your one thing.
Mm-hmm.
But first of all, why would she get Derek to be her coach? He's never been trained and is also not an especially good dancer.
No.
He's a fine dancer for his, like, hey, look, he's at a club and he's dancing. Yeah, he's good at that.
Yeah.
But he's not a choreographer.
No.
He just knows how to slouch in a chair.
Yeah.
And by teaching her how to slouch in a chair, that imbues her with all of Black culture, and she now is a hip-hop dancer.
Yes.
But she doesn't really dance any hip-hop.
No.
Or ballet.
Also, if she's this dance nerd again, if she's going to Juilliard for ballet, she's not focused on any other form of dance for, like, at least 10 years.
And also...
I stopped doing jazz when I was, like, 7 or 8. Because I said ballet is for me, and that's all I did.
And someone who's top 24 in the world, you'd think of that age.
Yeah.
She hadn't danced for months, and then she goes, I need to get back in shape. And he makes a joke like, oh, doing some push-ups? And she goes, no, that's not how I get back into shape. And we're thought like, oh, she's going to do some serious training now. No, she kind of like
she kind of like takes a couple classes ballet. On the side, yeah.
But is she even in classes or is she just dancing by herself?
No, she's doing class. She does classes at least once.
Okay.
But Derek's there for some reason?
She can't go anywhere by herself. She has some really troubling codependency issues
that
she needs to work on. She needs some alone time.
She does. She needs to go on a trip by herself.
She's going to fall apart at Juilliard.
She is.
Because she's going to have to dance without her mom or boyfriend watching her. And it's not going to go well.
At all times. Like, his full-time job is going to be sitting in that studio.
Well, he's going to Georgetown.
Yeah.
It's not going to work out.
Where is Georgetown?
Washington, D.C. So, and she's going to be in New York. You could take a train, but he's not going to be there every day.
No, because he's also studying medical school.
Nor should he be, because Black people are allowed to exist without just being there to prop up white people.
Oh.
Which is what this movie posits.
I feel like we're segueing into the racial part of this episode.
Yeah, let's do one last thing, because we have to wrap it up. So then Malakai's drive-by... That's too many guys for a drive-by.
Yeah, you were really upset about
because he's like, I need 7 guys. And it's like, you're taking one car. Anything more than 4 is completely unnecessary.
So there were 5 in the car, and he wanted Derek there.
That's too many. You're going to shoot one of your own guys if those guys are also shooting. Like, you're shooting across 3
and, like, everyone
faces?
Had a gun out.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, you're my second.
On the driver's side, popped up out the window and shot over the hood. I guess, I get the appeal of that, but I don't think that's going to be your best case scenario.
Yeah, there's just guns everywhere. There's just asking
people.
To shoot your own guys.
Yeah, so they didn't need Derek, is what
so
I want to say.
So then the drive-by doesn't work, and
wait, that drive-by, that doesn't work. They're driving off, and then the guy who's been shot gets up, shoots the car, and it explodes.
Yes.
fuck? In this movie, like, I get in action movies, everything blows up when you shoot it, but why would that happen in this one? Why wouldn't Malakai just get, like, shot or something and then crash the car?
Yeah.
It exploded.
Like, that's not how cars work.
No.
Right?
No.
No. That's what I thought, but I wasn't sure. It seemed silly. So Malakai is arrested, and everybody meets up at Steps to celebrate Sarah getting into Juilliard.
Oh, mean squeeze night.
The end.
Yeah. Well, this seems like a good place to take a little bit of a break and thank our second sponsor, and that is Pod Power and the Edmonton Community Foundation, because with Pod Power, our sponsors are making it possible for us to amplify the voices of Albertans and other Albertan podcasters. This episode, the Edmonton Community Foundation is helping us give a Pod Power shout out to Is This For Real? And I chose that one because you know who has a better take on these issues? The good people at Is This For Real? Because this is a podcast about various facets of Black life in Edmonton. In the first season of the show, called Breaking the Blue Wall, the host Omar Salifu explores anti-Black racism and policing and tells stories about policing in schools, accountability in Alberta's policing systems, and the impacts of police violence on Black Edmontonians. You can listen to the podcast and read more about each episode at isthisforreal.ca. And you can also support the work of these podcasters and them making future seasons on their Patreon. So you can check out Is This For Real?
Oh, it sounds like a very helpful podcast.
Yeah. There's somebody who you should listen to on takes on what it's like to be Black, not Julia Stiles or whoever wrote this.
Or yeah.
I don't know who wrote this. I'm going to bet money white. Do you want to take that bet?
No, because I'm usually wrong.
Well, what do you feel? Do you feel?
I feel white.
You feel white? Yeah. Yeah, it was written by a white person, which doesn't shock either of us.
No.
So let's get into a few of those issues that were kind of making you uncomfortable and you knew that I was going to bring up at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start off with that scene with the woman in the subway who's like kind of gave them a dirty look. So we are meant as the audience to believe that this is someone who is disagreeing with them because they're interracial couple.
Yes.
Right? Is that what we're meant to believe?
Yes, I believe so.
It seems like that to me, but I wasn't sure if it jumps out like that to everyone because, like, I got that a lot. Man, I, like, wouldn't hold hands with a girlfriend until I was, like, 30 in public because I was just so tired of getting yelled at. Oh, man. Sometimes they, like, throw stuff at you or on the subway. On the subway. It's anything goes on a subway.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not good. It was, you'd think it would be different in other countries, but when I lived in Korea, I had a Korean girlfriend, and we could not be like close to each other in public out there.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like old drunk men would attack me all the time.
Really?
Yeah. But what are we talking about? Oh, so this lady is giving them the evil eye, and how did you feel about this scene?
I think they were going for something that they didn't reach.
Yeah, that's kind of the theme of the movie.
Yeah,
like, hey, we kind of started something. We're not going to follow through or check back in, but we put it out there.
It's like sort of not quite.
Yes.
Say the last dance, sort of not quite.
And Sarah's reaction is, I don't know if it's appropriate or if it's terrible. Well, it's definitely terrible, but it might be appropriate as well. Because she's the 17-year-old and she's the white girl, so she can put on a show and thinks it's funny. Because she knows that she's not the one that's going to get violently attacked.
Yes.
And they've never been physically affectionate before this point.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not even sure if they're dating. And it was really strange. And I feel like there is some sort of like fetishization going on. Because it seems like she's like, oh, he's black. He's dangerous. And look at this. People don't approve. And it's like she's quite literally getting turned on by disapproval of others.
It's like he's literally taking you to the ballet. Like, let's not get too crazy.
Yeah. It was bad on its surface just as like a reaction to what she was doing. But the more you look at it, the more it becomes deeply problematic.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot of this movie's about the fetishization of black men and the danger that they present. Mm-hmm. And it's, it's regressive and it's bad. And I think a lot of people go like, oh, it was 2001. Yeah, it was 2001.
Yeah, we should.
It was not 1954.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely they were trying to make it seem like, oh, she's brave because she stood up and like, you know.
She was acting like an irresponsible child.
She was.
Is what she was doing. She was. There's nothing brave about dating the person you want to date, at least for what she did.
Yes.
Because she has, there's no downside to her.
No.
She doesn't get any of the repercussions. And that's kind of the story throughout the movie, is that she's brave for doing things that these people are doing every day of their life. Mm-hmm. But because she's white and she comes and does it, she's brave now.
Yeah. What's next on your list?
Well, let's talk about that Kerry Washington speech. So at this point, Nikki had kind of attacked Sarah. And Nikki is played as the villain throughout this movie. And like, yeah, she's mean and is aggressive out of nowhere, seemingly. Mm-hmm. But Kerry Washington, in a very measured way, says like, well, you have to look at it from her point of view. And it's about the good ones leaving, meaning that anytime we have a stand up black man in our lives, they leave. And well, before I say anything, what did you think about all of this?
I felt like if Sarah didn't exist, Derek would have left anyway.
Yes. Well, I don't think it's necessarily that he's leaving the situation. It's that they kind of take this, or at least in what the speech is talking about, that so many people, and I get where they are coming from, that it is seen as an upgrade to leave your culture in favor of white culture.
Right.
I can't speak to black communities, but I feel that in a lot of minority communities, it's like, oh, you're getting out. You're doing better by going and dating a white person and trying. It's almost by some people seen as aspirational, and that's like the danger of it, is that then by seeing that as aspirational, you're seeing your own culture as less than. And it's something that's more perpetuated by movies like this, where a lot of the time they're saying the same things. It's like, you're getting out, and that's the good thing. And this is just a symbol of that getting out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely felt uncomfortable with the way that they approached it, but I can see where they're coming from, for sure. I don't know if they did a good job of framing that idea. For,
definitely
like,
not
a very white audience, I'm assuming. I don't think that they did a very good job of it. And there's definitely other ways you could go about it. But this was one of the things that made me very uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't do a good enough job if they were trying to make this a teachable moment for white audiences, right? Like, I am not white, but I grew up in a very white community with very white friends. So I do like consider myself having like a white background for sure.
Yeah. And if most people were to look at you, they would maybe assume that you're Caucasian, right?
Exactly. So I definitely can see that they were trying something, but I think that if someone with my background is the person that they are pitching this movie for, white ballerina dancer girls, then I think that they need to do a better job of explaining what's happening on the, like, race side of this movie and keeping it a teachable moment and not making it offensive.
They treat race relations in this movie as Julia Stiles treats black culture in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
You take what you want and you just leave any part you don't want to deal with.
And it's, like, a cute, fun diversion.
Yeah. Like, in this part, that's a conversation to have without saying either side is right.
Mm-hmm.
That is definitely a worthwhile conversation to have. But it was thrown in at like seemingly arbitrarily and so close to the end of the movie. And then it's never really addressed after this. It's one of the few times that the movie tries to take something on seriously. And I commend them for that. Mm-hmm. Like, I did not think that speech would happen in this movie.
Yeah.
It was shocking when it happened because I was like, whoa, that's a slightly nuanced take.
Where did that come from?
But if you're not going to follow it up with anything, then what's the point of bringing it up?
Yeah.
if you're just putting it out there to be like, oh, let's just, we're just getting a conversation started.
Yeah,
your
it's just silence whatever.
On starting that conversation speaks volumes, and you're not willing to take a stand on it, is what this movie is saying.
Mm-hmm.
And then her reaction to it as well. She treats Chenille's words as like, this is saying you don't belong here.
Yes.
But I think what Chenille is trying to say is that you have to become aware of how things are handed to you that they are not handed to anyone else. And I think Chenille was just trying to get Sarah to like, just see things from our point mm-hmm. of view, because Chenille is in that group. She's right. not in Sarah's group. Although yeah. they are best friends, they are not coming from the same place. Chenille's coming from Nikki's place. And how Sarah reacts to this is the same way that a lot of people react to the idea of white privilege. If you bring up white privilege in conversation, and like, well, it's easier because of blah, blah, blah. It's harder for Black people or Indigenous people or whoever because of these reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Most people's first reaction is like, it wasn't easy for me. I grew up poor. And we're like, we're not saying that. And Sarah is in the same way of like, well, it's hard for me because like I'm real sad. My mom died. We get that. That is fine. And that is something that it makes you who you are. But that is not what's relevant to this conversation.
Yeah.
In the conversation of privilege, all people who bring up that conversation, and all Chenille is yeah. saying is that, yes, those things are hard, but it's not hard because of the color of your skin.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that a lot of people have trouble understanding. And I see why they have trouble understanding it, because look how it's portrayed in film, right? Sarah just takes it on herself. And there's no resolution to this. If anything, Chenille is the one who has to kind of take it upon herself to say, like, yeah, I said something too much. So, Derek, you have to go make things right because she mm-hmm. really loves you. Chenille is the one who, like, not quite apologizes, but she's the one who has to temper her point of view. Right. Sarah does nothing.
Nothing.
Sarah does not put in any hard work.
Everything's kind of, like, spoon-handed to her. And it's really awful to watch through the lens that we have now, being like an adult and like the current like Black Lives Matter movement and everything that like I feel like I'm trying to learn and I'm trying to be more like aware of what I'm doing. And
you finally realize that the Compton Clovers are the heroes of Bring It On.
I'm not admitting to that.
We're going to do a redo of Bring It On.
Okay.
Like Bring It On Redux. And I think after the conversations we've had in all of these movies,
mm-hmm.
I think you might come around on the Clovers are the heroes.
We'll see.
I don't see how you can. But okay, sorry. Go on.
And I think that back when I first saw this movie 20 years ago, I didn't have the worldview or like the experience and the knowledge to admit or realize just how badly this movie does in teachable moments and in the like possibility of how far they could have taken this.
Yes.
Because this is a predominantly white audience. It's an audience who doesn't have a big enough worldview to realize that this is like super racist and offensive, and they had a bandstand where they could have actually like done something with it, and I'm sad that they didn't.
You sound like me.
5 years. It's been 5 years.
Yeah, well said. I completely agree. If I could continue about how Sarah misses all of these opportunities. And like you were saying, the movie has these opportunities, just like Sarah has opportunities. Like early in the movie, when they have that kind of confrontation in English mm-hmm. class of like, well, do you read these authors? She goes, well, no, but some people do. Why don't they have her go and read those authors and then go talk to him about it? So simple.
Yeah, exactly. It just like, there could have been moments, quick montage of her in the library or up late at night.
You don't even have to put that. Just no. The next time they talk, she mentions it.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, yeah, I read James Baldwin. Here's what I think.
Yeah, exactly.
She needs to do some work in this movie. she gets everything, like you said, just spoon-fed to her. Mm-hmm. And then the part about her believing that we're all in the same world.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, she's not wrong, I guess, but she's only interested in the most simple answers that she can get. And it's like the whole, she's that I don't see color type, right?
Yeah.
Which people think is a very progressive thing, but it's not.
Mm-mm.
If you think that, like, I'm not racist, I don't see color.
That's a privilege.
I get where you're coming from.
Yeah.
We can't.
No.
Like, I can't, when someone tells me to go back to a country I'm not from, I can't just be like, huh? Why'd they say that?
Yeah.
It exists. And Sarah, and by extension this movie,
yeah,
believe that, like, no, we're all the same. All we need to do is dance and get along
dance
and learn
it
how
out.
To sit properly.
Yeah, exactly. And that, like, you can appropriate Black culture and that it's okay.
Yeah.
Like her wearing that cardigan on her head and steps the first night.
Well, that just looked silly more than anything. Because by the end of this movie, Sarah hasn't learned anything regarding this whole thing.
No.
She got Kerry Washington to just be like, oh, yeah, maybe I shouldn't have said that. She still believes that, like, we're all in the same world and color doesn't matter. And then she gets to go on and continue into this relationship mm-hmm. with the Black man and believe that, yeah, race isn't a thing. If people look at us weird, we'll just make out in front of them. That'll show
yeah.
them. Problem solved.
Exactly.
And the movie ends on that point of view.
Yeah.
We don't get Kerry Washington at the end. We get the two of them together and, like, yeah, everything's cool. And we don't
yeah.
need to talk about any
no.
of that.
No, it was very frustrating the way that they finished this movie.
And how rarely it was discussed. Because
yeah.
it's really, it's the woman on the subway and then that one speech by Kerry Washington.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a luxury we have when it's a movie about a white person coming into a Black world. If the movie is about a Black person going into a white world, everything is going to be about race.
Yes.
Like, you know what you should go watch? Out there, go watch O, a Julia Stiles movie from 2001, same year this came out, and it's about her in an interracial relationship. But in this one, the Black guy is in a all-white school because he's athletically talented, gets a scholarship, but he's not on the same level of all of these people. He's coming from a different background,
right.
Exactly the same as this. And race is at the forefront of that movie because
mm-hmm.
you can't do it the other way.
Right.
You have the luxury of bringing in race whenever you want when it's a white protagonist.
Yeah.
It doesn't work the other way around.
Mm. Yikes. Yeah. I don't know.
It just seems like this movie is too scared to tackle anything
mm-hmm.
real. If you're too scared to talk about the thing, don't make the movie about that thing.
No, just make it another high school dance movie where all the characters are white.
Or you could just not have all white people and it can be fine.
Yeah.
That's allowed too.
True.
Just saying out there, casting agents, I can dance, kind of. I only get cast as people with the word Indian in the title.
Oh.
Which is sadly true. Unless I write it myself, then I can play
right.
something else.
Exactly. I think this movie was bad.
It was pretty bad. It was pretty bad.
That's my big sweeping take on it.
And then they have some moments of subtle racism. Like, you remember when she calls her friend back home and she goes like, oh, you're in the hood? Did you see a drive-by? And Julia Stiles' character is, like, offended, saying, like, it's not all like that.
Yeah.
What happens about 20 minutes later in the movie?
There's a drive-by.
So the movie itself is part of that subtle racism that they critique.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's the equivalent of saying, I don't see color.
Yeah.
Right? Like, I think you're trying to do something good here.
Yes.
But it's a very misguided way of doing
it. It's extremely misguided. And it's stupid. Stupid.
Yeah, it was pretty stupid. And then there's all the things that Julia Stiles, or Sarah, is able to do. She can move to a, like, building that's all run down in the south side of Chicago. She can go to this school, which doesn't look like it's doing great.
Mm-hmm.
She can date a Black man who has had run-ins with the law. She can be in a single parent family and just succeed at everything. While every other character who has one of those things against them, it's just a complete struggle, right? Yeah. So this movie is unconsciously proving the point of privilege,
right?
I think they're trying to say that that doesn't exist and it's about who you are and how you dance.
Yeah.
But through the characters, like, you don't see Kerry Washington getting her scholarship to go off somewhere else. She still is going to be a single mom.
Yeah.
And life's going to be very hard for her.
Mm-hmm.
You don't see, like, Malakai, who apparently can do all of those things. At least Derek is convinced, like, you can do this. You can be great. You can get out. You don't see that for him.
No.
Right? But all of the odds, if you just look at it on paper without race, are all against Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
But she succeeds at every opportunity.
Yeah.
Because she's white.
Say it louder for the people in the back.
And not only does she succeed at every opportunity, every little thing she does that she's learned from somebody else, and we see her learn from somebody else, she is praised for.
Mm-hmm.
She just walks in there. She gets a helpful black woman to say, like, oh, here are the tips. Don't put your bag here. She gets a very, like, what I would assume is, like, one of the most popular guys in school.
Mm-hmm.
Loves her. No reason. She hasn't done anything to deserve it.
No.
She gets into Juilliard at the audition, which also can't happen.
No.
And also, she was bad at it.
Yeah.
And also, she fundamentally doesn't understand dance in a lot of ways, it seems like. But everything's just so easy for her. And she's able to succeed in, like, a primarily black space with no real effort.
Yeah.
Because she doesn't learn from anything. Like, she doesn't take lessons away. She just learns how to sit and grunt.
There's a lot of grunting.
There's
in this
a
movie.
Lot of grunting. Even, like, she can stand up to Malakai in the bathroom. She doesn't get slapped around. There's a woman getting slapped around in the bathroom.
Yeah.
But when Sarah comes in, he's like, oh, okay, well, hey. And just threatens her a little.
Yeah.
And then everything she does, like, whenever she has one of her little insults, which are the worst insults ever.
They are.
They were so, some of them, like, I didn't even understand what the joke was. Like, remember when Nikki says, like, oh, so you just bring this white girl to the Negro Club? And Sarah goes, I don't see any Negroes here. And everyone goes, oh! What was the joke? What did she do? Like, is her insult, like, we don't use the term Negro anymore, it's outdated?
I think so.
It's not really like a slam.
No, it's not.
But everything she does is propped up by the black people around her.
Yeah. Yeah, Chenille does a lot of propping up in this movie, for sure.
Oh, man. You know what?
What?
I just looked. I have notes on the race stuff. I haven't looked. I haven't started them yet. And I have 2 pages.
What? Oh. Indy, we've been talking about it for like half an hour.
I think we have to skip most of it. This, we can't do 2 hours on this movie. I do have the phrase, white people love to Christopher Columbus. Meaning to come into something, do something that already exists, and then be like, hey, look what I did.
I'm the greatest, yeah.
Oh, man. Okay, I'm just going to delete all of this. I said something about how she says to Derek that, like, you're not him. You're not like Malakai. And that just speaks on how they love to be like, you're not one of them. You're one of the good black people. Because he's smart and well-spoken and never the aggressor. And he's going to work hard and get out of the situation. And I think I talk about Jackie Robinson a lot on this podcast because he's kind of the greatest. But also what a lot of people don't know about Jackie Robinson, who was the first black player in Major League Baseball. He wasn't the best player. Well, he was the best in the major leagues. He wasn't the best black player. There were better players in the Negro Leagues. They put Jackie Robinson out there because he'd be the most palatable to a white audience.
Mm.
You couldn't put Satchel Paige out there because Satchel Paige is going to be Satchel Paige.
I don't know who Satchel Paige is.
He's the greatest. He's fucking amazing. But anyways, he was better than Jackie Robinson. But Jackie Robinson was college educated. He served in the military and he was an officer in the military.
Mm-hmm.
So, and he was, I don't want to say soft spoken because that's not who he was. He was a passionate and strong man, but he was able to hold his tongue, which a lot of other people couldn't do. And I feel like they're totally Jackie Robinsoning Derek's character. And
right.
they're making him, like, we're going to have this interracial relationship. Don't worry, he's going to be the most palatable to a white audience. We'll make sure we name him Derek.
Yeah.
Not Malakai.
Not Malakai. Yeah, they also made Malachi's name kind of scary.
When I think Malakai, I think of, like, an Amish dude.
Oh, really?
Isn't it a biblical name?
That's Mordecai.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. I think. I could be wrong. Bible friends, tell us. It just didn't seem as accessible a name as Derek.
True.
Right? Like, it seems scary and edgy.
It's more, yeah, it's more othered.
Yeah.
Like, Sarah and Derek, that kind of, like, is from the same world.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
They use every opportunity they can to say, like, sure, he's black, but, like, you know, he's not scary.
He's not that you could kind just of black. Say that,
yeah, really, yeah. That's what they're saying. That is what this movie is saying.
Are we the same person?
When you start eating cilantro, we'll talk.
Gross.
But yeah, that's what this movie is saying. It's both saying that there's good black people and bad black people, but it's also painting so many with the same brush and not allowing for different variations. When you're a white character in a movie, you are a ballerina who is moving from one city to the next.
Yeah.
You are a dad who hasn't had time with your daughter and is a struggling musician. When you're black in most movies, you're black. That is your character.
And that was the character.
Man, I'm just getting angry now.
Okay, well, maybe we should wrap it up.
All right. Let's wrap it up on a kind of a happy note. Remember how we loved Into the Spider-Verse? Because you have one main character, and it's his story. But then you have all these other characters who, even if they have 10 lines and 5 minutes of screen time, you know about them.
Mm-hmm.
I understand where Penny Parker was coming from. I understand the bond she has with this robot,
yeah.
which is a much more fanciful thing to get an understanding for.
Right.
But they do it well. Every one of those characters has their own desires, and sometimes they overlap and interweave with the protagonist.
Right.
But they are their own people. They exist for their own reasons, not only just to prop up Miles.
Mm-hmm.
In this movie, every character acts only to prop up Julia Stiles. And not only is that bad screenwriting because these characters' motivations are muddled at best, but it also comes off as super offensive because every character besides her is black and she is white. And we just have all of these black people existing to prop up this white person and teach her. And then not be celebrated for the lessons they taught, but celebrate her for her ability to kind of understand what they were teaching.
Yeah.
And that's why this movie is bad.
Whoa, okay.
Right? Does that seem fair?
No, I'm totally in agreement with you.
And that's why Into the Spider-Verse is so good.
Yes.
Not even that. It's just one of the... Go listen to two episodes ago. We talked about Into the Spider-Verse. It's one of the best movies
for, like,
the last
5 hours.
Yeah, well, now we're talking about this for 5 hours, so we should probably wrap it up.
Okay, we're going to wrap it up now. So, Save the Last Dance from 2001. Not a good movie.
Not a good movie. But you want to hear something crazy? I want you to pick more dance movies because I think they could be fun if they're not so problematic. Yeah. I like the idea of the dance movies are much the same idea as a lot of sports movies. Mm-hmm. It's a very simple plot. You know what you're going to get, and the ride is what's fun.
Yeah.
This one goes into some places which are weird and unnecessary or doesn't go far enough, perhaps. But
yeah,
I'm interested into seeing some more of these dance movies. Like your Step Ups, is that one?
I've never seen a Step Up movie. No.
How? I thought that was your time.
No.
No?
No.
When are they from? I thought they're from this same...
I think they're from the same time, but I just never saw one.
Okay. What about Center Stage?
I liked Center Stage.
I know my high school girlfriend was really into it. I don't think I ever saw it, though.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe we'll be watching that soon.
All right.
But yes, I do have some dance movies up my sleeve here for future podcast episodes.
I'm excited. I'd like to see them.
Mm-hmm. So if you have listeners, if you have a dance movie that is your favorite dance movie that you think we should watch, just send us a little message and let us know.
Black Swan.
So you can find us on social media at Instagram and Twitter at ILTYS and the number 2. You can find us on Facebook at I Love This, You Should 2-podcast. And you can email us your Google spreadsheets and top rankings of movies like my best friend and maid of honor Kim did at I Love This, You Should and the number 2 at gmail.com.
Kim, I need to give her a special shout out.
She's really...
She started listening to this podcast a couple of months ago and is now, from what I heard, on episode 106. She's just like blowing through them.
Yes.
And she'll send me a message every now and then going, regarding episode 98, you're very wrong. And I was like, I don't even know what episode
I'm like, Kim, you do. I had to tell her. I said, you do realize that I like pretty much never remember what I've said during an episode. So Kim sends me spreadsheets. She did a whole Rise of the Teen movie spreadsheet.
Wait,
which I'll have
Rise
to show
of
you.
The Teen?
The Teen movie, yeah.
Oh, Rise of the Teen movie.
Yeah.
Oh, what's on there?
I'll show you after. But she is like me, and her love language is spreadsheets. So she quickly makes up all sorts of spreadsheets for me, and I really appreciate it. So if you have a spreadsheet that you'd like to share with us about movies, please let us know, and we'll see you next week when Indy tells us what we'll be watching, and I get to critique it. That was a terrible ending. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.